Thanks very much. Just to be clear and lay things out, DPOP, which is the division I'm affiliated with in the School of Pharmacy, is the Division of Pharmaceutical Outcomes and Policy. And then I'm at this VA center with Morris. I appreciate the opportunity to speak with you all today because it's given me an opportunity to reflect on sort of the disparate streams of research that I've been involved with to date and my thinking about these problems. And made it clear that maybe there is some unified framework to what the research I'm doing. And feel free to interrupt me at any time along the way if you have any questions. So I'm going to cover a lot of ground, hopefully, in the next hour related to adherence generally and disease control, and then focus on medication adherence, and then move into a discussion of two types of approaches that have been implemented to try to improve medication adherence. And then I'll talk about some of the contradictions that exist between these two approaches and some policy options that have been at least talked about and starting to be explored to try to deal with this contradiction. And then along the way, talk about some of the current data and studies I'm doing currently. So there have been a number of terms that have been used to describe different types of patient behaviors and how they concur with evidence-based medicine guidelines for ideal recommended behaviors. And the two most common have been compliance and adherence. And adherence has gained favor in recent years because it reflects this idea of patients working collaboratively and actively with their providers to try to develop strategies for achieving optimal health behaviors, for example. But there's been a lot of work to show that adherence to recommended health behaviors is suboptimal. For example, in patients with coronary heart disease, there's three recommended behaviors related to dietary and physical activity guidelines and abstaining from not smoking. And all of these behaviors are suboptimal, and almost no one, only 7% of this sample, was actually adherent to all three of these recommended behaviors. So clearly there's a long way to go in these types of health behaviors, and this pattern also exists in medication adherence within three major diseases: diabetes, hypertension, and dyslipidemia. And if anyone knows of studies that fill in the other cells of this Venn diagram, I'd really appreciate those citations because I'd like to fill this out. And this, actually, filling out this diagram might make a very useful dissertation topic if anyone's looking for something. So there have been several methods for assessing medication adherence using different methods in terms of lab tests, like drawing blood, the serum drug levels, but that's quite impractical in a population setting, and it's fairly costly, or using electronic counters or MEMS caps, which can be fairly expensive to provide to a broad population and can be invasive for patients because they have to either record that data somehow or have that data recorded by clinic staff. And self-report is not necessarily reliable because of recall bias. But pharmacy records have been a very useful source of assessing adherence or refill patterns more accurately, partly because that data is quite convenient and available in a lot of health systems now that have electronic medical records or submitting claims for reimbursement. They've been very well studied in some recent publications, and they are not subject to recall bias and some of the other methods, and they correlate quite well with physiologic measures that we care about in terms of disease control. So, Steiner and others in the late 80s developed a couple measures that are, in a sense, what probably are the most widely used or gold standard measures for looking at refill patterns. And the first one, MedSum, has been useful in looking at, in particular, overstocking or hoarding of medications, in looking at changes in policies that might induce hoarding or overstocking. And MedOut has been useful in looking at suboptimal refill pattern behavior. And a colleague in Seattle, Chris Bryson, has developed a measure that takes the sort of best of both of these measures and integrates them into one measure that he calls the recomp measure, that has been very predictive in predicting disease control. So hopefully that paper will be out in the next year showing that. And this is a graph that he's shared with me that shows the relative predictive power in a regression of medication adherence on lipidemic levels for patients taking statins. And the bold line represents the dose-response relationship of this recomp measure, where you see a pretty strong relationship from going from no compliance, a level of 0 to a level of 1, which is, or 0.8 to 1, which is sort of the standard definition of being adherent, whereas the Steiner measures are somewhat flatter, and that's reflected in the lower R-squareds in the regression. And so in the VA context, where we've done some of this work, as in a lot of other settings, medication adherence is suboptimal. The rates for adherence to diabetes medications, hypertensive medications, and statins ranges in 70% range or lower, obviously suggesting that there's room to improve with effective interventions. And disease control is also suboptimal, even worse than adherence typically, which is true outside of the VA as well. And this suboptimal adherence and disease control exists despite established clinical benefits of optimal adherence based upon UKPDS and DCCT and patients with diabetes, showing that optimal adherence is associated with better glycemic control, greater odds of having optimal control, lower risks for micro and macrovascular conditions, and same in hypertension through a summary of trials in JNC7 and a recent study by Bramley and others. And more recently, some studies have tried to relate medication adherence and optimal adherence to economic outcomes in terms of utilization costs. And while these are observational studies that may be prone to bias, their results are suggestive that optimal adherence is associated with fewer hospitalizations and lower costs, despite lower total costs despite higher medication costs in diabetes and hypertension. But that was not found in depression, although again these are observational studies that are potentially subject to bias and selection issues. So given the potential promise in terms of clinical benefits and economic benefits of optimal medication adherence, what approaches have been explored to try to improve medication adherence? Well, the non-financial approaches have generally been sort of defined under the umbrella of disease management. And very fortuitously, Harlan Krumholtz and others have published a taxonomy earlier this week listing the principles by which one might define what a disease program, a good disease program might represent, and some of the goals and components of a good disease management model. And the ones that I find particularly of interest are goal 5 around having disease management programs being examined through careful evaluation of clinical and economic outcomes to ensure that they're effective in achieving the goals at which they're supposed to be attaining. And I'll refer to that in an evaluation that I'll be presenting shortly. And then lastly, making sure that there's an avoidance of conflict of interest, which I can also discuss shortly. So some of the non-financial approaches that have been used are structured around case management of different kinds, and the goal of which is to identify needs of typically high-risk patients to try to help develop tailored care plans for them and try to coordinate community resources and identify social support services that can help patients in achieving their adherence and clinical outcomes. And those case management interventions have typically been structured around pharmacists or nurses, but also, and typically having a physician overseeing or providing general guidance. And more recent interventions have been trying to work with trained lay people to be the case managers because they provide present a lower cost alternative to some of these healthcare professionals. And this case management is either done with a particular individual who's following patients or a team of providers who are following patients. And the other major non-financial approach is around self-management, which is basically providing patient education and training to help them build skills and identify resources that they can use to effectively monitor their condition and modify treatment independent of physicians and nurses when possible. And with that, in the case of medication adherence, there have been changes in medication regimens and packaging to try to facilitate some of that. And some of the two major financial approaches are basically around changing the prices that patients face for the medications they have to take, and potentially changing the income or resources they have to pay for those. The first being around copay changes, typically increases, and tiering medications, where health plans are changing their benefit structure so that generic or preferred medications are in the first tier, which has the lowest copays, and then in the higher tiers are non-preferred or brand name drugs that have higher copays associated with them. And typically those have gone together. And then the other approach is to actually pay patients to try to improve their adherence, which has been done in smoking cessation in some places. So what has been the impact of these non-financial approaches on medication adherence? Sort of what's the evidence base for this? First off, pharmacist case management has been explored in randomized trials that Morris has done in the in the late 90s and more recently in asthma and COPD, and didn't find evidence that this was protective. In diabetes, similar approach was also not found to be protective in a trial setting. And then the Asheville project that was run by Dale Christensen and others, which wasn't a trial, found that having a pharmacist case work with patients and follow them up was effective. And then there's some other evidence that's not trial-based or small trials that do have encouraging results of the impact of pharmacist case managers and achieving improved adherence in diabetes, hypertension, and dyslipidemia. So the evidence is mixed, I think, in some with pharmacist case managers. With non-pharmacists, there have been two general approaches, nurse case managers or trained lay people, and both approaches have been found to be effective in the specific diseases in which they've been studied. But there's in each of these approaches, there are studies on both sides, so I probably should qualify all of this. And then this team approach has been found not to be effective in diabetes care when nurses and primary care physicians, PCPs, have been linked together either independently or with IT like registries or with specialists, endocrinologists. But there has been shown to be a benefit in CHF and hypertension, although that hypertension studies were small trials or not randomized. And then there have been the whole self-management series of approaches with patient education to try to get patients to be more active in managing their own conditions. And there's been great promise based upon some recent Cochrane reviews and with some meta-analyses and structured literature reviews that have been published recently, showing these studies generally have not looked at adherence directly, but there's been indirect evidence around patient knowledge about ways to detect symptoms that might be suggesting they need to watch out and change their medications or be more diligent, and then looking directly at clinical outcomes like disease control. And so through those, we can potentially infer that there appears to be a benefit of self-management on medication adherence. And these have held for in diabetes and hypertension for the elderly as well. And there has been benefit for patients with asthma, but not for elderly patients with asthma, but there's no benefit for arthritis. So, but unfortunately, there's a number of barriers to the sustainability of these non-financial approaches related to both patient factors and larger system factors. In particular, a recent Cochrane collaborative by Haynes has found that interventions that are designed to impact long-term adherence are quite time-intensive and complex, which make them difficult to sustain, and that makes it quite difficult to integrate into a health system because payers have not been quick to sort of be supportive of these types of interventions with providing reimbursement to ensure that the team-based approaches to caring for patients are adequately reimbursed. So as a result, these types of programs have to be budget neutral or cost savings in order to be adopted by health systems. And in addition, there's some patient factors that limit the potential impact of these interventions over the long term. One of them being health literacy is not optimal, and health literacy has been shown to impact adherence. And there's studies that have shown, including one that we're doing now, showing that persistence in medication adherence is not optimal. Patients seem to, either because of novelty effects or polypharmacy, are not maintaining their medications over the long term like they need to if they have chronic conditions. And so there's a number of barriers that are sort of limiting the sustainability of these non-financial approaches to improving adherence. So as one exploration that I've been doing in collaboration with former colleagues at the University of Wisconsin, University of Washington, Fred Connell and Dimitri Christakis, we have been evaluating a disease management program that was implemented by a commercial vendor that worked for the Washington State Medicaid program in working with patients with asthma, CHF, or diabetes in trying to improve the quality of care and reduce utilization of services and improve medication adherence. And to this point, we've conducted the quality of care in ER and inpatient analyses, and we found that quality of care for asthma and diabetes patients has been improved, but it looks as though patients were more likely to go to the ER with all three conditions, and patients with diabetes were more likely to be hospitalized, which may suggest, I don't want to be too strong in my statements, that it could be that disease management is activating patients and potentially activating providers to sort of take action around their patients' conditions that may induce more service use in the short term. But at this point, we haven't yet looked at the medication data or the outpatient utilization data to be able to see whether the full set of effects follows what the utilization effects in ER and hospitalization are. So that's work we're going to be continuing once I can get IRB approval. So now there have been a number of financial approaches that have been conducted to try to improve medication adherence, which I mentioned, but just to remind you, one being an increase in the medication prices that patients are facing for their medications, and then the other is to pay patients to improve their adherence. With no published studies to date that I know of that have shown whether paying patients to stop smoking or to take their meds have been effective. If there are such studies, I'd appreciate someone letting me know about them. So I'll focus on the medication price studies. So what's known about that? There's been sort of three major populations that have been examined in this literature generally. A general population of employed people, Medicare beneficiaries, at least in Medicare Plus Choice, where there was drug benefits offered typically, and then within patients with chronic conditions. And so in the first set of studies around the general population, studies by Huskamp, Goldman, and Gibson looked at changes in tiering or increases in prices, that is copay increases, and their effects on medication use over time and switches in types of medication between tiers. And these studies basically showed that either increases in tiers or increases in prices basically led to slower increase in the use of medications in populations, switching to lower cost medications and discontinuation in essential medications. In the Medicare Plus Choice studies done by Tamblyn and Sue, where the Tamblyn study is a landmark study in this area that looked at elderly and patients on welfare, found that a decrease in benefit generosity, either through capping of benefits at $1,000 in the Sue study or an introduction of coinsurance in the Tamblyn study, led to increased non-adherence in both groups. And then lastly, the WHO study that was just published a couple months ago in the New England Journal looked at patients with diabetes, hypertension, or dyslipidemia in Medicare Plus Choice plans in California, found that a capping of benefits at $1,000 was associated with lower adherence to essential medications for these patients, and fewer patients who were had disease control, whether it's in all cases glycemic control, blood pressure control, or lipid control, and as well as increased utilization of the ER and hospitalizations. And was really encouraged to see this study in some sense because it confirmed a hypothesis that I had in a VA study that I'd had, but in a sense steals the thunder a little bit of a study that we're completing now that I started with colleagues in Seattle at the Seattle VA that we're finishing up now, and had great hopes that the findings of that study would be end up somewhere prominently, because very few studies before, almost no studies before the Sue study, had examined a policy intervention in conjunction with evaluation of multiple outcomes, adherence, disease control, and utilization, and costs. Typically, studies had looked at a policy intervention and one of those sets of outcomes, but hadn't put it all together. And that was basically what we're doing in this study, looking at the effect of a copay increase in the VA on medication adherence, disease control, and utilization and cost for veterans with diabetes and or hypertension. So we were very excited about the results of this study, and it'll be interesting to see how receptive the field is to these. So we were inspired by all these previous studies looking at patient factors associated with medication adherence and policy factors associated with medication adherence. And so based upon the knowledge that sort of has been gleaned up to this point, we thought we would try to use this natural experiment of a VA copay increase to try to understand the relationship of some of these patient factors and policy factors on medication adherence and disease control. And so these effects that are listed here are sort of what we've summarized based upon the literature to date, and informed the design of our study. So in February of 2002, the VA increased copays for a 30-day supply of meds from $2 per fill to $7 per fill, which for veterans who are generally, that is VA users who are using the VA as their regular source of care, they're typically fairly low income and typically quite ill with multiple conditions and are on multiple medications. So a $7 per fill copay represents a real burden in a way that may not be the case in an employed-based population. And we focused on three conditions, diabetes and oral hypoglycemic agents, hypertension and ACE inhibitors, calcium channel blockers, etc., and dyslipidemia, because it's a triad that typically goes together, and statins have been shown to be quite cost-effective, whereas ACE inhibitors have been shown to be cost savings in prior work by CDC effectiveness group and Rosen and others. And the nice thing about the VA is that we've got tremendous administrative data, and so we could actually measure very closely the medication patterns and disease control over this time period, 2000 to 2003, where the copay increase occurred sort of right in the middle. And we looked at four sites, because we were, for this study, we were really interested in trying to get at some of the detail that's maintained in local VA centers about veterans who have to pay co-pays. Well, I'll just jump to the next slide. Let me jump. There's three types of veterans. There's veterans who never have to pay co-pays because in their time in the military service, they incurred a disability that was sufficiently severe that they were eligible for free VA care. They paid no co-pays for medications, no co-pays for health care. And then there were veterans who had to pay co-pays all the time because they were not low income and they were not sufficiently disabled to receive free care. And those two groups are quite distinct in their risk, in their demographic profile. That is, the veterans who never have to pay are quite much riskier, much sicker, but are younger than the vets who don't have to pay, that do have to pay copays. And then there's a middle group that's quite heterogeneous, who some of whom have to pay copays some of the time, who we wanted to include for completeness sake, but we're really more interested in the comparison of this A group and the Z group. So let me go back. So we focused on these four sites because these local VA medical centers are able to provide veterans who have to pay co-pays waivers to on a temporary basis to be exempt from co-payments if their income is low enough, high enough that they're not exempt from co-pays because of low income, but they're not high enough so that they have enough income to really pay for them. And so they, if they get, in a sense, a hardship waiver to exempt them either for a short time or sort of prospectively. And but that data is only maintained locally, so that was one source of data that we needed to obtain, and it wasn't, and it's just because of IRB and other purposes, other burdens, it's just not possible to do this all across multiple centers. And in addition, this group of veterans who have to pay co-pays, some of them have health insurance that are covering these co-pays, but it's not very clear in the widely available administrative data who those people are, and that's not tracked very well in the nationally available databases. So we wanted to try to identify that carefully in these sites. So for those of you who don't know the VA healthcare system, it has been getting a lot of good press recently, particularly because the data is so great. It's the largest integrated healthcare system in the world. There's 21, the whole country basically is got a VA system of some kind in it. In every state, in many counties, have access to a VA within 50 miles or something. And so the whole country is broken up into 21 networks and that are sort of regional organizations that link the big VA medical systems that are the centers that you see, maybe like in Durham here, as well as community-based outpatient clinics that are community clinics that provide primary care and mental health care, and then there's nursing homes as well that are affiliated within each of these networks, part of the VA system. And in 2003, there were 7.1 million veterans that were enrolled in the VA to be eligible for care, and 4 million of those were actually getting medications from the VA, had at least one fill in the VA in 2003. And they got 200 million 30-day scripts in that year, so tremendous volume of medications being provided by the VA. That may change with Part D for the elderly folks, but that's another study. So, as I'd said, the VA is a great place to do this kind of evaluation and examine this natural experiment because we have this comprehensive data on medications, on their lab values, and on their utilization of outpatient clinics and hospitalization visits, or inpatient stays. And in addition, because there's these two distinct groups, we have a non-equivalent control group that's co-located with those veterans who do have to pay co-pays. And so it sets up a potentially nice study design if we can capture all the important sources of confounding, which I have to admit we don't. So the main research questions were, did the copay increase impact adherence for these three groups, disease control, and utilization and costs? And just to give an example, here's a graph of the per month percentage of patients in each of the groups who are adherent to their oral hyperglycemic agents between July 2000 and December 2003. In the red line, the Z group represents those who have to pay copays all the time. The A group, the black line, are those who never have to pay, and the green line is this heterogeneous group. So there's three things I want to note in this. The first is that the red line, the folks who always have to pay copays, their adherence was the greatest of all groups, but then declined most precipitously after the copay increase, which was basically right in the middle of this graph, and right after January 2002. The second thing is that the folks who don't have to pay copays ever had suboptimal adherence, lower adherence than those who had to pay copays, which gives some indication of their general non-compliance, and which was reflected in their risk and other complicating factors they had in their number of conditions and things. And their adherence surprisingly declined as well, but a little more modestly. And then lastly, in the post period, once the copay effect was in place, the adherence for the folks who had to pay ended up being lower towards the end of the post period than those who didn't have to pay copays. So, to some degree, what we expected, but we expected the veterans who never had to pay copays for their adherence to stay fairly flat, but it did decline as well. Nonetheless, we found several interesting findings. Adherence was suboptimal and did get worse, not radically worse, because if you see on the y-axis, the percentage of patients, there was a max of about 85% patients in a given month who were adherent, and the worst adherence at the end of the study period was about 68% in a given month were adherent. And by that I mean, by adherent I mean having 80 to 100% of the days in a month having medication on hand.